Hi, I'm Batman.
And I'm Superman.
And this is the Reviewers.
We don't have a name.
Yeah.
We're gonna talk about movies. I need these to see. I'm not Superman. I'm Jordan.
He's just Jordan York. Yeah, and so the movie that we're talking about is Batman v Superman.
Dawn of Justice.
Justice did in fact dawn. Obviously, spoiler warning, I'm gonna put that somewhere.
Probably like right here.
Yeah. And doobity-doo.
Right.
I think Vlog Brothers owns that. Anyway.
Yeah.
And so what we're going to do is we're going to have our opening statements. First, a quick PSA. But our opening statements will take exactly 1 minute. We'll have a whole timer, probably about there. Maybe like there. I haven't figured that out yet either. Let's have fun with this. So, do you want to do your PSA first?
Sure. Before we begin, I want to say you can go ahead and get the timer set up.
Yeah.
Before we begin, I want to make a general statement about the movie-going experience and like, in general. This is, collectively, our third time seeing the film, and each time has been relatively a different experience than the last. This time we went, and there was a baby crying almost the entire movie. Didn't get removed. Somebody complained about girls talking in front of us. Nobody said anything about the baby. Parents. Talking to you now. If you want to go on a date night, or if you want to go see a movie, and you can't get a sitter, and you really want to go see something that came out like Batman v Superman, bite the bullet and try to find a sitter, or wait until you can, or just, you know, wait to watch it online, or when it comes on DVD like the average American. Do not take an infant to the movie theater because you don't have the patience to wait to see a movie, or to wait to make sure that your kid has a sitter. It ruins the experience of the movie for the people watching. It ruins the movie for you because you're sitting there embarrassed because your kid's crying the whole time. And, yeah, it's just genuinely annoying.
Reverse PSA. If you hear a crying baby in the theater, don't be a dick! Okay, like, parents have this child! And what, they're supposed to wait 10 years to go see a movie? That was my reverse PSA.
I don't know how the whole thing's going to go, by the way. Okay.
A lot of this will be edited out. Okay.
No, leave it all in.
All of it? Jesus Christ. No. Alright,
It's cherry. Anywho.
Alright, so we're... Spoilers. We're gonna start the clock with Jordan's take. On Batman v Superman. He has 1 minute. And go.
Okay, so how I felt about Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. I've seen the movie now 3 times. I can honestly say I didn't particularly enjoy it. I enjoyed it. I didn't enjoy it for what it was trying to do. And I didn't get what it was trying to make me get. This is supposed to be the start of the DC Extended Universe. The DCEU is what they're calling it. And I feel like it fails to properly set up the events coming forward. That being said, it succeeds in making me want to see the future movies. I want to see Aquaman. I want to see Wonder Woman. I can't wait to see Suicide Squad. Comes out in a couple months. I have a lot of problems with the movie overall, the way the story has been told, the way the characters are portrayed. I don't think that this is a proper telling of the Batman-Superman story. I don't think this is a proper handling of their characters and their individuality. I don't think this is a proper handling of the character of Lex Luthor. I don't think this is a proper handling of the character of Doomsday. Spoilers, he's in the movie, but you knew that.
Hey, there we go. Right. It has its own noise.
Oh, look at that.
Okay, my friend?
Yep.
Alright.
And...
Oh, it was Jolly Rancher.
Begin.
Okay, so overall, I actually really liked this movie, but granted, I actually thought it was going to be a steaming pile of shit. Like, I expected nothing whatsoever. He has watched, like, all the trailers and got super hyped for it, and I honestly feel that that's part of the reason he was disappointed, because I didn't watch any of the trailers, thought it was going to be bad, I thoroughly enjoyed myself. Now, a couple things. Lex Luthor was not Lex Luthor, he was actually Alexander Luthor Jr., which they do mention in the film, but they play it off like he's like just a crazy Lex Luthor. Anyway, I liked a lot of this movie. And the particular thing is that everyone had their own reasons for what they were doing. They all actually acted either emotionally or rationally. There was no, I'm doing this just because I'm a crazy idiot, you know? It's... I overall loved it. They touched on a lot of things that a lot of superhero movies don't, which is collateral damage. You see a lot of people die, and superheroes at some point have to answer for that. So, yeah, that's actually all I had.
All right. That was your minute. All right, so now we're just going to have... There's no time to how long we're going to go. We're just going to have...
Open dialogue.
General discussion until both of us feel like we've said all that we need to say. So let's get started on this. So, as you can tell, we've obviously had varying experiences with the movie. We've seen it 3 times. We've seen it together 3 times. Let me just start out by saying that just because I don't enjoy the movie doesn't mean that I think Robert's an idiot. I mean, I think he's an idiot for other reasons, but I don't think he's an idiot for liking this movie. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion. This is strictly our own, so mm-hmm. We're going to have varying degrees of... And I also want to point out for the general public that I think the consensus of this movie is the general public seems to really enjoy it. I think the fans, myself included, are the ones that have been the most severely let down. And Robert, a fan as he isn't as hardcore into the source material
as I am.
There are things that he enjoyed, there are things that I thought could have been better, there are things he thought could have been better, and there are things that I enjoyed as well. So...
Oh, I should also preface it. I'm not a fan of Superman. I never was. I kind of thought he was a boring character, and Luthor, I always thought he was a boring character. And so when they kind of didn't do anything like Lex Luthor, I was actually pretty happy.
Yeah.
So just want to get that out of the game, because that was a big reason.
And I want to preface, too, that Batman is my favorite character of all time in any cinema, comics.
So despite that he's wearing a Superman shirt, he just has the body of Superman. That's what
hanging on abs, right? But, let's start with the things that we didn't like. All together that we didn't
like. Okay.
I'm gonna come out and I'm gonna say it. I didn't like Batman. I loved Ben Affleck. I thought Ben Affleck was great. I was one of the people at the very beginning that was like, give Batfleck a chance, he's gonna do great. You know, his Daredevil was a little subpar, but that wasn't his fault. It was the studio, and I think a lot of this comes down to studio interference as well, to varying degrees. I think a lot of this is also difference in ideologies with the director and the source material.
Sure.
I like Zack Snyder. I like the things that he does. I'm a big fan of Watchmen.
Going on dislike.
Something just went off in the background.
Thanks, Alexa. While he does that, I'm gonna...
Alright, so... But Batman in this movie... They're playing it off, like, if you know comic books like I do... They're playing it like it's the Dark Knight Returns Frank Miller version of Batman. He's old, he's been through a lot, he's lost a Robin, he's lost friends, presumably.
He's the boxer in the last round. So
right, he's the brawler. He's not the world's greatest detective. He's really not the world's greatest detective in this movie.
Nope.
My God, he's not. He's overtly violent for Batman. I know Batman is a violent character. He is overtly violent. This Batman kills.
He uses guns. Like,
and
not even on his car. Like, just uses straight-up guns.
He uses guns, which is a big Batman no-no. He never, like, his parents were killed by a gun. And he's sworn off guns. And I mean, granted, the time we see him using a gun, it's a dream-esque sequence vision.
Right.
It's still very jarring to see him shooting people with a pistol.
Speaking of which, on the topic of dislikes, there was an entire future sequence. I mean, I think it was unnecessary and just out of nowhere.
I like the aesthetic. I like that you see the giant Omega symbol burned into the ground, which means Darkseid's coming. You see parademons, which honestly, I've been waiting to see parademons my entire life in a feature film. So, I mean, there's things that this movie does that will get your blood pumping and get you pumped for the future, which is what it's trying to do. But I think that, and adversely to the film as a whole, it focuses so much on the world building and so much on we have to introduce Flash, Cyborg, Aquaman, Wonder Woman, and it introduces those characters in the worst way possible you could ever introduce
just
anybody.
The worst.
Except for the Flash, but then they kind of go back on it. I mean, it's very style over substance, in my opinion. Which is what, going back to Zack Snyder, I like a lot of his work. He is very much he's a visionary director. He's credited, and most things, if you see him, like the visionary director of Man of Steel, of Watchmen, of 300.
Sure.
He knows how to put a shot together. He knows how to make it look like it's a splash page from a comic book. This whole movie looks like a comic book brought to life, and I'm not going to knock it for that. Visually, it's stunning. Story-wise, it falls apart in a lot of different places. Its characters do things that make absolutely no sense, in my opinion. Because Batman is overly violent and isn't the way that you should introduce Batman into a cinematic universe. Superman does absolutely nothing in this movie. People give him crap for being a boring character. He is the most boring character in this entire piece. The whole movie is about him struggling with the fact that he's trying to do right things and everybody is trying to put their own impressions of what they want him to be onto him. And he can't live up to everybody's expectations. He can't save everybody. He can't do everything like he's being pegged for being able to do. And he struggles with that the whole movie.
They call him a god. Like, legit, they have that word scrawled everywhere.
Everywhere you see. And that's
actually a big plot point, is that the public is calling him a god.
That's comics. They do that in the comic books, and they do that in the TV shows.
Sure.
And all that stuff. And anywhere you look in anywhere you look in the Superman story and that has him in it, you're gonna see Christ mock-ups and monikers all over the place. And this movie especially, they don't shy away from it at all.
Spoiler alert! I mean, like, we've done enough of those. When he dies, there's actually, like, a beam of heavenly light going onto him, and then, like, everyone else looks like the disciples, and in the left-hand corner are two crosses to symbolize the other two people that died on the hill, with Jesus, him being the third cross.
Yep. I think that, and then I'll shut up so Robert can say some more negative things.
Yeah.
I think that it's trying to do too much, which is what the problem I have with this film. I have the same problem with Iron Man 2, and Iron Man 2 has a lot of the same... I noticed this time around, Iron Man 2 has a lot of the same beats Senate hearing Iron Man 2 has. Internal conflict with another superhero, friend kind of thing going on. The death of innocence is a big one. Like, honestly, Superman, the metaphor of Christ dying is also the death of Superman's innocence, I think, in a way.
Yeah.
Is a big thing. And they just, not only do they try to put too many characters in, which actually, I didn't feel like this movie had too many characters. I felt like it had too many storylines it was trying to juggle. And that's another thing, is I watched this movie and I can feel like I'm watching the thing and there's just pieces of movie thread that I could pull out here and here and here that they don't do anything to tie up or do anything to service the main story. The Dark Knight Returns, like I already said, is a giant influence on this movie. If you see that armored Batman everywhere, that's straight out of the Frank Miller graphic novel. You see Doomsday, they weren't shy about showing us Doomsday in trailers. And the minute I saw Doomsday in a trailer, I was like, Superman's gonna die in this movie. It didn't ruin the moment for me, and when I first saw it, I still felt impacted by it. Seeing Superman die on screen is like, I've been waiting to see that, honestly. I didn't want to see it in this movie, but it still hit me in a place. But it tries to juggle so many different things in so many different ways, and at the end of the 2 hours and 41 minutes you're sitting in the theater, everything's just kind of, a couple things have stuck, but the rest of it's just fallen flat. And you know, those are my negatives that I get from the whole thing.
My negatives, I mean, there is a lot of what he was saying. I mean, not all of it, and we'll get into that. But particularly, in it, there were a couple extra storylines that just didn't need to be there. I personally counted three that I saw absolutely no use for whatsoever. And the rest, I mean, they had a purpose, but not a very good one. Like, there was an instance where Lois Lane hides a spear of kryptonite in a pool of water. And then later on, the building is collapsing, and she has to go get the spear to kill Doomsday, who has emerged out of nowhere, mind you. And that was kind of bad because he was like a cave troll mixed with an Uruk-hai. I know I'm a Lord of the Rings nerd, but I mean
he was one of the shittiest pieces of CG shit I've ever seen.
It was really bad considering the time and the money that was put into this film.
Yeah,
and he was just kind of shoehorned in at the end. And I guess he's a big character. I didn't honestly know. Doomsday.
Well, honestly, it's like I said, like he is a big character, yes, but his only motivation, his only gimmick in the comics was to kill Superman.
And I didn't know that watching it the first time. The first time, I loved it. I felt like it was amazing. But I treated it more as Lex Luthor's story, which is a really weird way to watch a movie, is to see it as the villain's story. But in this one, he actually kind of had a story, as opposed to like most, which, I mean, yeah, the heroes get a fair amount of time, but you kind of just don't know what's happening with the supervillain until it all just kind of comes to fruition, usually. Anyway, sorry, things I didn't like. Lois Lane goes in to get the kryptonite spear, which is going to be used against Doomsday, and Superman has to save her because she's in a pool of water trapped and, like, drowning and shit. And, she gets the spear, but she's drowning, so Superman saves her, gets the spear, and decides to be the one to shove the spear in Doomsday. The issue I have with that is that if it weren't for the Lois Lane plot, what could have easily have happened is been like, hey, Wonder Woman, you're not allergic to kryptonite, go get it yourself. Honestly, she can fly, she is, I mean, depending on what universe you look at, as strong as Superman, and isn't weak to kryptonite, and so she would have been able to kill him, and everybody lives and is jolly. But, I mean, like Jordan was saying, they built the Doomsday character so that he could die, and so it felt like the movie, like, the third time I watched it, it felt like the movie kind of fell apart just at that specific area. I thought beforehand it was pretty well done. I mean, not like the most amazing thing in the world, but, you know, it held its weight, I feel.
Okay. Positives.
Yes.
Let's see. Like I said, I can't praise the visualization enough.
It was amazing.
And there are things in this movie that I, as a comic book fan, have been dying to see on screen. Superman gets hit with a nuke and is a floating skeleton in space.
When
again,
flakes of him are off.
Ripped straight from The Dark Knight Returns. The Batman and Superman fighting, obviously, is a big thing that you've been wanting to see in movies forever.
Who's winning a fight? Batman or Superman?
The fight isn't... And I don't like the way that they did the fight.
Yeah.
Not necessarily because it's, you know, there was an obvious winner, because you kind of... The conceit with superhero fights, I feel, is that you have those two characters that the fans want to see duke it out, trying to resolve their differences in a physical way.
Mm-hmm.
But they always end in a place where it's like, you're not really sure, it leans more towards one, but the other one still had a definite shot. This one, straight up, if Lois Lane hadn't come out of nowhere, or if Superman hadn't squeaked out the name Martha, Batman would have killed him.
Yep.
He would have put that spear straight through his chest, and that would be the end of it.
Straight up, killed
straight
Superman.
Up. And the stupidest—I didn't put this in my complaints, and I should have. The stupidest conceit ever is that the fight stops because both of their parents' names, both their moms' names,
are
Martha. Which,
yeah.
As a fan of the comic books, I never connected those dots until this movie. So thank you, Zack Snyder, for doing that for me. That was the stupidest way to get them to quit fighting. My lord.
Okay, so for those of you who are a little lost, basically, Superman's mother has been captured. Martha Kent, thank you. Martha Kent has been captured. Martha Wayne is dead and, you know, Batman's mom. And so, basically, the plot of this is Lex tells Superman, alright, kill the Bat, bring me his head in an hour, or I'm gonna kill your mother. And so, right at the end of this big fight, where Batman is pretty much taking a really obvious lead, and a lot of people, I'm guessing, wouldn't care for that, but he's loaded up with kryptonite. Anyway, where was I?
They're in the middle. They're basically
Martha.
Yeah, they're in the middle of the fight, and
so
Batman,
he's like, save Martha! Right as Batman's about to take the killing blow, and Batman stops and goes, Why'd you say that?
He has a Christian Bale, "Who's the trigger?" freakout on him.
Yeah.
Which I keep saying is a homage to Christian Bale's Batman voice because it sounded like it.
It was like PTSD for Batman.
Because he has a vision of his parents dying and his... It's so on the nose, the more that you watch it, the more Martha is just ingrained in your head as you go through. They start the movie with the credits, the opening credits are entirely the death and funeral of the Waynes, Thomas and Martha Wayne. And I know I'm not alone on the internet as being a person that's like, enough with showing Batman's parents getting killed.
I totally agree.
We have, every single time we introduce this character freshly, we have to go back and show his parents getting killed. There is a show on television, Gotham, that starts with the death of Batman's parents. You don't need this. I know this is introducing the character into a new universe, but everybody knows how Batman came to be.
I'm going
to
agree with you there.
Everybody knows that his parents were gunned down, and the reason he wants to be Batman is because he wants to get justice. We don't need you to keep showing us that his parents were killed.
And it's not even that, like, everybody knows that Batman's backstory, but pretty much anyone who's going to see Batman v Superman knows Batman's backstory.
Yeah. And it's not that... I mean, and don't get me wrong, like, it was creatively done.
It was really well done.
It was probably the best way I've seen them killed on screen.
Yeah.
But it was just, yeah, I don't need that anymore.
And then there was this part that, like, it wasn't supposed to get laughs, but the first time we saw it, it straight up got laughs. And it was actually in the middle of this montage. Like, first you have them dying, and overlapping this montage is him falling in a well, and then being lifted up by bats.
Mm.
Like, straight up Jesus style.
And the first time I saw that, I was like, I don't like that at all.
Yeah, a lot of people, yeah.
I was just like, that's stupid as shit. And then the only way it saves itself is Bruce Wayne has a voiceover saying, "In the dream, it pulled me into the light." So he's having a dream about the thing.
Yeah, as opposed to it actually happening.
Yeah, it's just...
But the audience definitely took it literally and laughed.
Yeah, it was ridiculous. It was absurd. And I mean, visually, it was a cool visual, but it was still just like,
man. It was completely
and
ridiculous.
That's my overall complaint is that visually the movie is stunning, but it's focused so heavily on the visuals that story comes second. And that is a thing that happens with all of Zack Snyder's films if they're not inspired or based off a storyline. Watchmen succeeds because the script's already mapped out for you. It's an amazing story by Alan Moore. And all Zack Snyder has to do is take that graphic novel, put it into a script, and then shoot the panels of that comic book. And that's what you get when you watch Watchmen, is you're watching the comic book come to life. This movie is, you have to try to put several ideas coming back and forth and make it original, and not just rip it straight from comic books, which they still do.
Yeah.
And you get all the great visual beats and the great montages of Superman saving things, and the introduction to Batman, which I'm going to say right now is the greatest introduction to the character we've ever had on
really
screen.
Yeah,
even down to, at the end, the warehouse fight where he's going and knocking criminals back and forth to save Martha is fantastic. It's like pulled straight out of the Arkham video games. But it's just, it's style over substance. And
okay, so we're on the good. We're on the good. So I'm going to rope it back in.
All right.
Okay, I want to really quick take us through the story as to what I feel Lex Luthor was doing this entire time, or Alexander Luthor Jr., who has red hair and, you know, is not bald because that was Lex Luthor. And, I mean, keep in mind, I didn't treat this as Lex Luthor because I think just Lex Luthor as himself, kind of boring. And so I was okay with them. Basically, he is a psychopath and he's kind of just really, really full of energy.
I have to interject and say that because his name is Lex Luthor, you're going to have that.
Yeah.
You're going to have the expectation.
There's still that stigma of it should have been.
This was not Lex Luthor.
This was not Lex Luthor.
And I'm gonna come out and say I didn't mind Jesse Eisenberg. I didn't mind what he did.
Yeah.
I didn't mind his performance. I came out of the movie going, I really thought Jesse Eisenberg kind of, you know, it did it for me. He wasn't Lex Luthor, though.
He wasn't.
He was, honestly, he was an over-the-top zany, he was the Riddler. He was like Jim Carrey's Riddler. He was in the grand scheme of things, he was a Batman villain before he was Lex Luthor.
Absolutely.
Just maniacal crazy. He was the Joker, if anything. Which is so weird to me that in August we're going to get a new version of the Joker. And if he's a little bit more tamed down than Lex Luthor is, I'm going to be really... I don't know how I'm going to feel about that. But...
Okay, anyway, so Lex Luthor's journey. This is how I feel it happened based off of what was said in the movie. And I will... he can interject at any time throughout this because...
And I will.
And he will. Because I might be wrong or miss some points. So... Lex Luthor, or Lex Luthor Jr., he first sees Superman as he is crashing buildings, you know, with General Zod in Man of Steel. That's when he's introduced to the world. He may have had prior knowledge.
It's also the same way Bruce Wayne is introduced to Superman as well.
I mean, basically, it even starts with a big title thing of...
Metropolis, Mankind Meets the Superman.
Exactly. So basically, the world knows about Superman now. There's no denying it. And you're looking through Batman's eyes at this point. You're watching the destruction unfold. You're seeing...
I'm just going to say, to the credit of the movie, is...
That was a really good...
A lot like Man of Steel. The first, like, the beginning of the movie is what it really does bring you in and gets you kind of... gets you in there.
Yeah.
It's... Basically, it plays... It's the last... It's the final act of Man of Steel.
That really...
It's the Superman, Zod, the world engine goes into the Phantom Zone part from Man of Steel. But it's from the ground's perspective.
Yes.
It's... So, if you were to go back and watch Man of Steel and then watch Batman v Superman and kind of sync it up, you're seeing in Man of Steel Superman's perspective of the whole thing, which looks grand and amazing and just like, you know...
Fantastic.
But then in this, you're seeing the people on the ground's perspective, namely Bruce Wayne, and it's horrifying.
Absolutely. He runs up and first sees this guy who's on the floor whose legs have been completely disabled from a falling piece of debris, and Batman, you know, lifts up... or Bruce Wayne lifts up the metal.
Bruce Wayne. It's...
This is Bruce Wayne.
It's Bruce Wayne, which I've...
Who runs into the line of fire.
Which is... that's comics.
And so. Also, there was a lot of montage, like, a lot of feeling like it was 9/11. Like, if you listen to what people say about 9/11, like, there's a big dust cloud that comes in, you can't really see, you can't really hear. It actually does that really, really well. Mm-hmm. And it's because everywhere there is falling buildings and people dying.
Yeah.
And I think... Batman, and I think, honestly, Luthor is attributing a lot of those deaths to Superman.
Well, I'll agree to that. That's Batman's driving hatred for Superman and paranoia with Superman in this movie is because he brought death and destruction to Metropolis, and he killed a lot of people, friends of Bruce Wayne's, when Wayne Tower went down in Metropolis.
He's actually, like, on the phone with one of his friends as he dies.
Yeah, which
as
is...
As he's crushed to death.
Which is very... Or incinerated. Whatever. Whoever gets him first, Zod's laser vision. Or,
yeah.
It's very... Like I said, the opening 15 minutes, fantastic. And a great introduction to Bruce Wayne in this universe.
As well as the conflict.
As well as the conflict, yes. Now, go ahead and go into your point with Luthor, and I will argue it with you.
Okay, so Luthor is seeing basically the same thing that Batman is seeing. He's seeing this death and destruction, and he's seeing people call this man who is responsible for so many deaths, a god. He's calling him a god. And in his mind, he is attributing this to the same god that wasn't there for him in his childhood. He mentions his childhood and how his dad was abusive. He says, if I can remember this correctly, he says, God was not there to save me from my father's fist or his abominations. Basically, I think, insinuating that there was rape or something very wrong going on there. And that's terrible. You already have a feeling for him there. And I think he attributes, and he says right after that, he says this big line, see, I learned a long time ago that God cannot be all... Or if God is all-powerful, he cannot be all-good. If he is all-good, he cannot be all-powerful. And that's the reason that that's his driving force for bringing Superman down. Because everyone's calling him God, and he's like, where the hell was God when I needed him? Where the hell was God when all these other people needed him, you know?
And that's good sympathy for a villain.
Yeah.
I would agree that it's conveyed very well in the final act of the movie.
In the final act.
So you don't get any of that. You get bits and spatterings like Lex Luthor is on this, but you're not enough to pick up on during the movie. And that's where I think one of the things it could have done better is that you spent all this time with Bruce Wayne in the beginning of that.
Mm-hmm.
You could easily have interjected Lex Luthor in there as well.
Yep.
There's no reason you couldn't have interjected Lex Luthor in there to kind of give you that emotional feel to Luthor that you have to Batman. Because honestly, it makes you feel like, in the grand scheme of things, Batman is the antagonist of the piece at the end of the day. And Lex Luthor is kind of just the driving force to get them to conflict, which is so just convoluted and absurd.
Okay, going back. This is Lex Luthor's story. Okay, so he sees Superman, and he starts devising a plan. He wants to first learn all he can about him, and he wants to destroy him. And so he decides, hey, I need to get into that ship, I need to start analyzing everything, I need to figure out a way to kill this god. And he starts doing that. He learns about the kryptonite, he learns about the ship, and he's trying to get permission from the Senate. Is it the Senate?
It's the Senate.
Yeah, it was the Senate. Basically, to move the kryptonite in. And he calls it a silver bullet, I mean, in reference to, like, a werewolf. And he says, basically, we may not... And he's justifying it, saying, we won't use it, but if we have it, then we'll never need it and not have it. We won't have to, quote, depend on the Cadmus and monsters. And yeah, he literally says it that way, and I thought that was kind of cool.
And so it's just the problem that I have with his whole trying to get to a point where he can kill Superman thing is, one, it makes you, again, at this point where he's doing the villain telling you his master plan thing on the top of his tower talking to Superman, he tells him everything he's done to kind of coerce Batman into hating Superman.
Yep.
It tells him all of the, and at that point, it makes you realize that, so the whole movie, the start of this movie, it makes you, Batman and Bruce Wayne is trying to get information on something called the White Portuguese, which makes you think, he makes Alfred and the audience think it's bringing a dirty bomb into Gotham, when in reality the White Portuguese is a ship from Lex Luthor bringing in the kryptonite into Gotham, or into Metropolis, without having to go through, like, getting it, the import license or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Trying
to do it legally, because Lex Luthor is still...
Right. So, they get the White Portuguese in here, and they get the kryptonite, and Lex Luthor has it. Batman tries to get it at one point, and murders a lot of people trying to do it, but he doesn't. Superman stops him. A little too late, Superman, but... And then there's a hearing, a Senate hearing. There's Senate hearings all throughout this movie.
Yes.
There's so much interjection from the media, which, again, is a thing that they do in the comic books, especially in The Dark Knight Returns, is you hear the people's reactions and you get the public opinion on everything.
That.
And I liked it, too. I thought it was a good way to kind of just get your two points of view.
Yeah, get not only just the two points of view, but get general people's reactions.
Mm.
Like, I think a lot of comic book movies miss out on that.
Now, again, it falls apart because once he's going into and telling you all the things, that there's a point where Superman finally shows up to a Senate hearing, and the guy who lost his legs, and it's called the Black Zero event. They never say it in the movie. It's a comic book thing, I know. He gets a wheelchair from Luthor that's got laced with explosives. Superman doesn't see it. Blows up everybody in the Senate building.
Yep.
Which I thought they were going to try to blame on Superman, and they don't. They say it was this guy, but then they're all like, but Superman probably could have seen the bomb. He didn't do anything about it. And even he's like, I'm afraid I didn't see it because I wasn't looking. I don't.
He doesn't care anymore,
which is a big... It's a touching moment, but it's not really handled as well as it could be. But anyway, so that happens. Batman goes ballistic because during this time, he's getting... he's asking, why has this guy not gotten any compensation or, like, reprehension?
Like, he's been sending him checks.
Check.
Why hasn't he received
them? From survivor's funds. And they say he has been, but every month he's sending them back, and nobody showed this to Bruce Wayne yet.
And there's been writing on it that says, like...
Like, you let your family die, you're blind, Bruce Wayne, I will haunt you. And it turns out that it's all Lex Luthor doing it.
Yep, all the writing, all the return checks.
Like, the whole time has been Lex Luthor. Yep. Like, basically, if you think about it, Lex Luthor's ruined this handicapped guy's life.
Yes.
And then convinced him to basically be a martyr.
Yep.
And to get Batman to steal the kryptonite that Lex already has, that he could make the weapons he wants.
I disagree.
That's exactly what he does, though.
No, it's, I'm saying I'm not disagreeing on what he did. I'm disagreeing on the why.
No,
I don't think it was just to get Batman to hate Superman. I think he kind of wanted the public on his side. I really do. If he didn't want people to, you know, be against him, he would be up front. If he wanted people against him, but no, he sort of hides all his moves from the general public. Because he wants people to see that this is not a god.
Right, but no, that's not, that has nothing to do with the
Batman. He even says it at the end.
Right, but that has nothing to do with him wanting Batman to do it.
The checks, yes, but not the bomb. That's what I mean, the bomb.
The bomb, but it's...
The bomb is the entire public.
The bomb's the entire public, but he knows Batman's watching.
Yeah.
Because he sent the last thing he got, like this one came in today, it's the one that says you let your family die.
Yeah.
And so he's banking on Batman going and getting the kryptonite, forging the kryptonite weapons, and doing all of this stuff. I'm not saying that he's doing it because he doesn't want the public to know it's him. I know that's why he's doing it. But his whole goal is to have Batman be the one to murder Superman.
But I think also it's because even if Batman doesn't murder Superman, or it's the other way around, I think he still wants people to see that Superman is not all-powerful, he is not God, and all these people that have faith in him,
but,
he wants to crush them.
Right, but the reason, the bombing itself doesn't do anything to...
It does, though. Like, they lit an effigy of Superman on fire,
but
basically
that,
saying he's to blame.
But that's the opinion. People have that opinion about everything. There's a whole thing about something that happened in the desert in the beginning of this movie that is a frame-up by Lex Luthor to frame Superman, which, by the way, the government in this movie is the stupidest government I've ever seen. If you want to blame Superman for something that happens in the desert and think he killed a bunch of people, why don't you perform an autopsy on the people that are dead and
see
that...
They light everyone on fire.
No, they didn't.
They did. You can see it in the kerosene. They have gasoline canisters. You see flames building up. Sorry.
I don't think that was...
They did. I looked very closely.
We'll go back and watch it again.
And that's why.
But either way, there were... All right, their bodies are burned. You're still going to find...
Vision.
You're still going to find the bullets there.
You could.
You're still going to find those experimental LexCorp bullets that Lois Lane conveniently finds in her journal because somebody shot it on the ground for some reason.
Shot, yeah.
So,
bullets go everywhere in confrontations. So
right, but they would... But they would look at all of that stuff.
Right.
Either way, it's just a giant contrived mess to get these two characters to finally come into conflict with each other.
I think a lot of the public stuff was for the public. I think it wasn't a contrived mess. I think these were two different, basically, things. The checks were for Bruce Wayne, but the bombs, the shootings, everything...
It's contrived because in that scene... He says everybody's gonna be looking at this because he's at this point he's already kind of in the process of creating Doomsday.
Yeah.
And
it's already on a timer.
Yeah. And he's like, so we've got all the cameras are gonna be at the ship waiting to see, you know, that what that God goes down when it counts. You either bring me the head of the bat. He wants him to go to Gotham and kill Batman.
Yep.
To save Martha, or Martha is going to die. So he's banking on Batman going over there and banking on Superman either going over there and killing Batman or killing Superman.
Yes.
And if by some miracle of circumstance Batman does manage to kill Superman, Doomsday's still going to come out of that cryo chamber.
I think he wasn't banking on Batman winning. I think he, honest to God, thought that Superman was going to win in his heart.
But it...
And then Doomsday... Basically, I think how he thought this was going to go down was basically... Superman kills Batman, brings the head of the bat. Yeah, the head of the bat. And then it doesn't matter, because, hey, here's the devil to finish you off. Boom. Two birds, one stone.
Yep, but then, you know, so the rest of the world's dead, too, because then nobody can defeat Doomsday.
Well, if it shook out like it did in the movie, where they both died.
No, but...
I mean, he couldn't have known that, though, so I can't really make that argument.
Right. And if he would have killed Batman before he probably... He would have killed Batman before he got to that kryptonite spear, so he wouldn't have had the kryptonite weapon to kill him.
Or he killed him, like, around there, or... I mean, just realized that kryptonite was in the area.
Either way, it's one of the points in the movie that all the threads, you can kind of... It falls apart.
It does fall a little apart.
And so... And that's... All of that, though, is easily solved if you don't put Doomsday in the movie at all.
Yeah.
All
if
of
you,
it.
If you had ended it with Luther, yeah.
You could easily... And then devote whatever the 45 minutes left of the movie that it does on the violence and the Doomsday, Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman fight.
Sure.
By the way, Wonder Woman was great in this movie.
She was.
I loved Wonder Woman.
She kind of came out of nowhere in the fight, but I mean...
In the fight,
she
kind of came out of nowhere, but she was introduced fairly early
yeah,
on.
Yeah, she was. It wasn't like, hey, here's Wonder Woman who hasn't been here at all. No, she
not
actually
like
had,
they,
like, lines and shit.
Not like they do with the Justice, not the rest of the Justice League. Oh my god. It's just, I feel like we've been talking about this for an awful long time. So let's kind of wind it down.
Okay, so last statement.
Honestly, I want to just say that I thought we were going to have a very different experience going into this. I thought I was going to be on cloud nine, love the thing, and just
and
be
I
like,
was gonna hate
and
it.
That he was going to just not enjoy a single part of it. We saw it opening night, our Thursday screenings, the preview screenings.
Yep.
And I was like, you know, it's good. I definitely need to see it again because I don't know how I feel, which is the same way I felt about Man of Steel, and I love that movie. And he came out being like, I loved it. I loved everything
I thought it was amazing.
We went and saw it a second time, and I came out going, this is garbage.
Yeah,
this
he
is
really didn't
the
like it.
Worst. And I know he wishes we were doing this then because I would just be a giant pile of...
Right, he was like, he was ready to hit me because I'm like, I was smiling away like, that was so great.
That screening, though, like I said, the experiences were always different. The Thursday night screening was fine. That night we went, it was supposed to start like 9:30.
It didn't end up starting
until like 9:50.
Yeah.
And then we were there until after 1 o'clock because it's 2.5 hours long almost.
Yeah, it was bad.
So it was a bad experience for me then. And this one was just kind of like, there was points in the movie where I was watching where I was just like, okay, I could honestly leave now. It's only been an hour. We haven't even gotten to the main conflict, but I feel like I know what I'm going to feel.
Yeah.
And then, like, we sat and we watched all of it, and then I was just like, you know, I'm glad I stuck around because I saw this.
Yep.
Overall, like Iron Man 2, it's trying to build a universe. It's trying to expound upon this DC cinematic universe.
Mm-hmm.
And it puts that before the story, which is what everybody wants to see, Batman and Superman punching each other in the face.
I didn't want to see that. That's honestly why I thought it was going to be bad. I thought it was just going to be Batman and Superman punching each other.
And I mean, I knew it was good. There's these guys on YouTube, Mr. Sun. If you don't, whoever's watching this, Mr. Sunday Movies, look them up. They're geniuses. They would call it Batman v Superman. They'll punch for a bit and then they'll be mates. Which is kind of what happens in this movie.
Batman
literally has the line when he's saving Martha. It's okay. I'm a friend of your son's.
Yeah, and that was so
Five minutes prior, he almost stabbed him in the heart.
Right, yeah.
And it's in, like, real time, because he's got 10 minutes to go and save Martha.
But, I mean, what else is he going to say? Hi, I'm a guy who was just beating the shit out of your son trying to kill him.
I mean, hey, anything. Don't lie to the poor lady. Don't set on fire. But no, like... As a movie, I still find myself having a good time with it. As a movie, it
holds its own. It's good, not great,
it's,
not excellent.
It's not amazing. I go in and I look for all, now I look for all the things that I still love. Like Parademons does it for me.
Yeah.
Seeing Batman in the Dark Knight Returns armor kind of does it for me too. And the Batman-Superman fight all together.
Yeah.
The death of Superman still kind of, like, even this time, he'll hit me in a place a little bit.
A little. But aside from Doomsday.
But yeah, it falls under the weight of feeling like it has to do all of this at once.
Yeah.
Because Warners is so late in the game trying to get this universe started that I feel like they have to just kind of shove it all in your face.
Yeah.
And be like, yeah. And now, like I said, Marvel did the exact same thing with Iron Man 2. They had Iron Man, and then they had the Incredible Hulk movie, which was okay but not amazing,
yeah.
Which is set in the same universe. And then they had Iron Man 2, which had to set up Captain America and Thor and introduced all of S.H.I.E.L.D. for the Avengers.
Yeah. I need to watch that movie again.
Yeah. It has a lot of the same flaws and literally some of the same plot points.
Yeah.
And Amazing Spider-Man 2, we're not getting any more of those movies, but it does the same thing. It's trying to build a Spider-Verse on that movie.
Yeah.
And that's, I feel like there's a general lesson to be learned with trying to get...
Don't do too much at once.
You are going to make money with this movie. Like, I said it when it was first announced, and I'll say it now because it's proven. You put these logos on screen together, and you're going to make a shit ton of money. Because it's characters that the public really likes, that they want to see in a movie together. And you're going to make your money. You don't need to worry about trying to rush and get all the stuff put out at once.
Just make sure the content you have is good.
Right. So that's how I feel about it. I was disappointed in this film, but I guess it accomplished its goal of making me excited for the future.
Yeah.
I can't wait for Suicide Squad this year. And honestly, I was looking forward to that more, like, before this movie even came out. I was like, I'm more stoked for Suicide Squad than for Batman and Superman. But I'm stoked for that. I'm definitely excited for Wonder Woman. I can't wait to see a solo movie with Diana. And then Justice League. I can't wait to finally see everybody in action.
I'm stoked too. But honestly, like, okay. Are you good?
Yeah, I'm good. That's
okay. I honestly thought that it was pretty well thought out. There were some parts that kind of didn't need to be there. They had a purpose, but it wasn't altogether needed, mostly, for a lot of the plot threads. Not a lot, some of the plot threads. And honestly, overall, I liked it for a lot of the things it did that a lot of other superhero movies don't do. It had a lot of points where, like, every move, you saw the public's general reaction. Every move, you saw the collateral damage. Every move, you saw...
Can I tack one more thing on before I wrap up?
Go for it.
A big problem with Man of Steel that a lot of people had was that...
There was so much
destruction and collateral damage. This movie is so afraid of repeating the same mistakes,
and it would
do that... Because there's a point where Batman leads Doomsday back into the city, because that's where the kryptonite is.
And he says, don't worry, it's abandoned.
This port is abandoned. Nobody's been there in ages, which is bullcrap. There's always going to be homeless people around the abandoned port.
Gotham?
In Gotham, yeah. When they fall out of the sky, Doomsday lands on Stryker's Island, and they make a point to be like, it's abandoned, you know, it's uninhabited, nobody's here. They do it a couple points during the movie. It's like, come on, guys.
Yeah.
So I
appreciate it because it told the side of the story that happens, but usually just isn't told. And that's what happens to the common person. And I really, really loved that. And I loved that Lex Luthor, almost, rather than seeming like the puppet master, to me, he seemed more like the spear, the head of that public. The public that was against both. But that's just my view.
Yep. And this is, like I said, everything is our personal opinion. Obviously, there's things that I don't agree with him, and things he doesn't agree with me. It's just that we're still buds, though.
Yeah.
I mean, forget the symbols on our shirts. We don't want to punch each other. But honestly, I'm more curious to see what you guys think about the film, if you've seen it. And by the way, any negatives that we may have given, don't take that as a reason not to go see the film.
And it's definitely not gospel, because as you can see, two people can go in and love comics or love the shows and have very different experiences.
Yeah, so definitely give them your money, show them support, because
absolutely.
You want to see more of these movies.
Yeah.
I want to see more of these movies, and hopefully we'll see them done right.
Yes.
So if you guys have any questions, comments, you want to tell us what you think, if you think that we're just a bunch of assholes and you don't want to, like, you want to argue with us.
If you want to comment on my shitty hair or beard.
Or, you know, just, you know, go ahead and hit us up in the comment section below. Hit like and subscribe, share, do all that stuff. We're kind of a fledgling page starting out. We've got a lot of original content from him that is beautiful.
Soon.
So we hope that you guys enjoyed this discussion and look forward to more of these. We'll probably do one for Captain America, because that comes out next month. So.
Yes, absolutely. Might do it the night after, though.
Right, like first reactions.
Definitely
let us know what you think about us and what you thought about Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice. thank you so much for watching and being patient with both of us. Mm. I'm Jordan.
I'm Foster.
And we want to thank you again, and good night.